Namaskar. Today's lecture is part of a new course being introduced by Indus University based on my recent book on Sati. This is the book, and this series of lectures is based on this book. Today's lecture will be the first of a series of 6 lectures, and today we will discuss Sati, debunking common misconceptions. There has been a lot of misunderstanding about Sati, and it is some of these misunderstandings that I want to address today. The first thing I want to say is that the number of instances of Sati after independence have been around 40. But if you look at the amount of literature that has been produced in post-independence India on this subject, one would tend to get an impression that it is a very widespread practice. So the first thing that I want to say is that the number of instances of Sati post-independence does not match the amount of work done on this subject. Now there are certain questions that have to be answered on any discussion on Sati. The first point is, was Sati sanctioned and mandated in the religious legal scripts, texts in ancient India? So, it's surprising to note that ancient Indian religio-legal texts had no definite reference to Sati for a very long time. In the Rig Veda, there is the famous funeral hymn, and that has been used by critics of Hinduism to say Sati was made mandatory and obligatory from Vedic times. But what does this funeral hymn say? This funeral hymn addresses a widow. It tells her that sit next to the dead body of the man, moisten your eyes with ghee, and then get up and resume your place in the world. Now, it is interesting that the word Agre is earlier, was replaced by the word Agni, that is fire. So, when did this take place? Was it deliberately done to convey an impression that Hindu religious scriptures made it obligatory for a woman to commit Sati? Actually, the noted expert on the Dharma Shastras, P.V. Kane, he said it was not a deliberate mistake. It was not a deliberate act, but it was an innocent slip. Now, the first person to write on this was H.T. Colebrook. In 1795, H.T. Colebrook, who was then a young person who had just come to India, he wrote his first paper on the duties of a faithful Hindu wife. In this article, he said Sati was mandatory, obligatory according to the Hindu Shastras. Sir William Jones, who was also in India at that time, at once said this is an incorrect reading and you have not read the text properly. 25 years later, H.H. Wilson, a very noted Orientalist, he reread this hymn of the Rig Veda according to the rules laid down by Sayan. Sayan was the great expert on the Vedas in Vijayanagar times, and H.H. Wilson said it does not refer to widow burning. So this is the first point that I want to make, that the Rig Vedic funeral hymn does not ask the widow to immolate herself. It just says, moisten your eyes with ghee and get up and assume your place in the world. And I've discussed with you the wrong interpretation done by H.T. Colebrook and how he was corrected by two noted Orientalists, William Jones and H.H. Wilson. So that is the first reference as far as the ancient Sanskrit texts are concerned. Now after that, we move to the next body of Sanskrit texts, that is the Brahmanas and the Griha Sutras. The Brahmanas and the Griha Sutras do not mention Sati. In the time of the Mauryas, we had Megasthenes, the Greek ambassador to the court of the Mauryas. He does not mention Sati in his work Indica on what he saw, what he observed in the Indian subcontinent. Also, Kautilya in his Arthashastra does not refer to Sati at all. Now, the writers of the Dharma Sutras and the Smritis, they discuss the duties of a wife and they do not recommend Sati. Manu describes wives as worthy of being worshipped and as lamps that lit the household. And he said that a female is supposed to receive the protection of the father when she is a child, of the husband when she is get married, and of the son after the husband passes away. So he does not mention that after the husband has died, the woman should immolate herself. After Manusmriti, the next work that we should consider is Yajnavalk. He said that wives were the gifts of God and they should be respected and valued. He lays down strict rules for a widow but does not recommend immolation. We learn about Sati also from the epics, the Mahabharata and the Ramayana. In the Ramayana, the wife of Pandu, King Pandu, that is Madri, she is shown as determined to immolate herself. The assembled sages and family members try to dissuade her from this act. They say it is her duty to look after her young sons. But Madri immolates herself because she is consumed with a sense of guilt that Pandu died because of her. In the Mahabharata, the father of Krishna, Vasudev's four wives do immolate: Rohini, Devaki, Madri and Bhadra. But many of the wives of Krishna, they retreat to the forest and live a life of ascetics, though some immolate themselves. But the Mahabharata also says very clearly that the widows of many fallen soldiers, they survived and carried out their funeral ceremonies. Now we come to the Ramayana. It is very clear in the Ramayana that none of the widows of Raja Dashrath immolates, nor does any widow of Ravan immolate. So in the Ramayana, it is very clear that there is no instance of Sati in the family of Dashrath or Ravan's family. Some instances of widow immolation are mentioned in the Purans. Some Smriti writers had begun to refer to it, but they recommended an ascetic life for the widows and not immolation. The Vishnu Smriti did not consider immolation a religious duty. It said, a good wife who preserves a chaste life after the death of her Lord will go to heaven like perpetual students even though she has no son. After that, there are several other smritis like the Vyas Smriti, the Parashar Smriti, and the Brihaspati Smriti. They praise Sati, but Brihaspati lays down the rights of widows. So it's clear that he is not recommending immolation because he is specifying the rights of widows. Vatsayan, Kalidas, among others, mention Sati. But Bana, who is the court poet in the time of Harsha, in his work Kadambari, he condemns the practice of Sati in very clear terms. Meghatithi compares practice of Sati to Syan Yajna, that is black magic, which a man performs to kill his enemies. So that means he is also coming out clearly against Sati. And many other people of that period also expressed similar views on Sati. But from the early 8th century, some writers began to praise Sati. Among the earliest was Angira. He recommended concremation. Concremation means the widow being buried or cremated at the same time as the husband. That means both are to burn on the funeral pyre together. And he said, a woman who does this will live in heaven for as many years as there are hair in the human body. That means she will live in heaven for crores of years if she commits Sati. But at the same time, there are other texts that are composed that clearly express grave reservations about this. The Mitakshara, composed in the 11th, 12th century, does not recommend this rite. By the late medieval period, when Raghunandan's Riti appeared, Sati was not uncommon. But all the smritis that were composed till this time had carried no instructions on the methods and the rituals to be followed when Sati was being practiced. And in the 18th century, we have a guide to the duties of a woman prepared in Thanjavur. It is called Stri Dharma Padhati. It is written by a Pandit Triambaka. And he is writing in South India and he is concerned about the threat to Hinduism posed by Islamic encroachments, Christian missionaries and European traders. So he is writing in this context about how to preserve Hindu dharma from these many threats. So he recommended Sati as a way of salvation for women in this troubled scenario. But even he says that the option of leading an ascetic life is always open to a widow whose husband has passed away. So he is not saying that Sati is mandatory for all. He is recommending it in a particular situation, but he is qualifying it by saying a life of austerity is always open to a widow. And at the same time, we have another text, Mahavir Vantantra, and it condemns Sati. So what we are seeing is that there is no recommendation or even mention of Sati in the ancient religio-legal texts for a very long time. And when certain people begin to comment on Sati, they are always qualifying it by saying that an ascetic life is always open to a widow. So, to say, as some people have said, that Sati was enjoined in the ancient religious scriptures is a totally incorrect statement to make. So we should always be very clear that sati is not mandated in the ancient religio-legal texts. That is the first point that we have to keep in mind while discussing sati.